My name is Dirk Seller. I'm Professor of Marine Conservation at the University of Western Australia. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker, Daniel Pauly, who is Killam Professor at the University of British Columbia in Vancouver, Canada, and is also an affiliate professor here at UWA. In addition, Daniel is the principal investigator of the Sea Around Us, a research initiative that investigates the effects of fishing on marine ecosystems around the world. I've personally known Daniel for nearly 30 years and have the great fortune of being able to work with him closely for the last 20 years or so. And yet, every day when I'm around Daniel, there's always something new that I learn, or an interesting fact about either science or life on our planet. He's a treasure trove of knowledge and insights, with topics ranging from basic ecology or basic animal biology to fishery science or marine conservation, or even the evolution of human languages. So indeed, when you talk to Daniel, you never get bored. Daniel has a truly global life history, and life history is a term that us biologists like to use, so I had to weave it in here. He was born in Paris, brought up in Switzerland. He studied at Kiel University in Germany, where he earned a master's degree based on fieldwork in Ghana, a doctorate that was inspired by his fieldwork in Indonesia, and a professorial habilitation based on work conducted in the Philippines and elsewhere. His contributions to fishery science and marine conservation include, among many other things, I only picked three examples here, the documentation of marine ecological processes such as fishing down the marine food web, or concepts such as shifting baselines, and FishBase, which is the world's leading online encyclopedia of fishes, in which UWA is now a formal consortium member. Daniel's outstanding contributions in the field of science have earned him numerous awards and prizes around the world. And if I would list them all, you would have to listen to me speak for a couple of hours, so I won't. Instead, I only want to mention two that stick out to me. In 2003, the popular science magazine Scientific American, which you might know, has named Daniel as one of the 50 most outstanding world leaders in science. And in the middle of last year, Daniel was appointed Knight of the Legion of Honor, which is France's highest order of merit. Thus, you can indeed consider Daniel an international recognized leader in his academic field and an exceptional researcher whose accomplishments have major impacts in our world. Now, I hope you've all been given a straw. Okay, hold on to it. This is a crucial and high-cost scientific instrument that forms part of this lecture. Okay, and with that, I hope you have joined me in welcoming Daniel for Fish Must Breathe. Hannah, do you know how to turn this? Oh, it's muted. Do you know how to?
It's perhaps here.
No, no, on there. You're late. That is on, but this one is muted.
Two PhDs.
It's green.
It's on.
We can hear.
It's green.
It's on? Okay.
So, my pleasure to be here. Because of this kind of appointment that I have with the University of Western Australia, I will be here every year. Every year you will have to listen to some stuff. I hope you're going to like it this year. So this year I will present what really was my passion since my PhD. I invented that when I came back from Indonesia in 76, and I wanted to explain to myself how fish grow. Why do they grow the way they are? Because there were in Indonesia too many fish, and you could not study one and then the other and then the other. They were too many. And so I thought I would study how fish grow, I would find out how they grow, and then we could infer how they grow from general patterns. And we have achieved this, actually. And I will present the theory that that is based on that. So try to breathe while you read this. Try to breathe while you read this. and only through your stroke. And what you will notice is after a few minutes, you will want to breathe a little bit more. And if I were to tell you a cheap joke, you'd be laughing, and you couldn't. You have already given up. Here I see lots of people who have already given up because it's actually difficult to breathe through a straw. That's a fish. The fish are limited in the amount of oxygen they can get per unit time. Because they breathe a medium that contains 30 times less oxygen than air. Because that medium is very viscous, very thick, and it's 805 times, 850 times heavier than air. And then the diffusion, the rate at which molecules exchange, touch a membrane, is 300,000 times faster in air than in water. So it is very difficult for fish to obtain the oxygen they need. We have no problem getting the oxygen we need. We breathe, we don't think about it. About 1% of our energy expenditure every day is on breathing itself. Fish expend far more, up to 30-40% on breathing. If you see a fish in a pond, in an aquarium, in a Chinese restaurant, you see them working to pump this water across their gill. That is a huge fraction of the energy goes to breathing itself. Now, for this reason, because breathing is so hard, they have developed big gills. About 420 million years ago, when the fish didn't have jaws properly, the head, in some reconstruction that we can do, appeared to have contained barely any gill, and they were small, very small, and they were probably very sluggish. But now we know that fish move a lot, and the head is, if you are in the market or you have taken a fish out of the water, the head is full of gills. And in big sharks, especially basking sharks and whale shark, it's a Boeing 747. The front is enlarged to allow for big gills. And in fact, the need for gills is so big that they combine feeding and breathing because they filter feeders. The gills are also used for feeding food. Now, there is one fish that lives in the tropics that is huge and has a head like this, very small gills, the air breathing arapaima. They are proof of concept because they are obligatory air breathers. If one of these arapaima, you can see how big they get, is forced to stay underwater, they die, they drown. And they can have, therefore, a pointy head as they do. Now, what? You're not in the wrong lecture, don't worry. This is, because I'm also French, this is something that I always want to present. Lots of our movies about gangsters and stuff in the 50s or 60s, they use cars like that. The prominent part of this car is a radiator in front, right? And what is a radiator? What does it do? Well, it gets hot water from the engine because it's an automotor. It is explosion, lots of explosion in the engine. It gets hot water, and this hot water goes through lamellae. And the lamellae, they are exposed to air that comes in and gets warm as it cools the water. So the water that gets in is hot, the water gets out is cool. And the air, on the other hand, I hope this one helps. The air with the pointer. No? Can you help?
Press the same button again you just did.
Okay. Now, the, where's the pointer?
This is one pointer?
Yeah. Okay, that's the pointer. So these are the lamellae that the water goes through and the air goes. Now, when the air has gone past the lamellae, it is hot. It is hot, though it wouldn't cool anymore. So there is no point putting another lamellae back there. They can be only one or two layers of lamellae, and then the air is too warm. Then if you, so you, your radiator can grow in width, in height, but not in depth, right? You have only two dimensions to make a radiator bigger. So if you want a big car, you have to have a bigger radiator, but you cannot make it deep. It remains a surface. And that is exactly the same thing with gills. You see, the water gets in between the lamellae, and the oxygen is taken up. It goes into the capillaries, and when it gets past this lamellae, it has no more oxygen. So basically, you end up with lots of oxygen at the beginning, then no oxygen at the end. There is no point putting gills behind gills. So gills can grow only as a surface, but it cannot go in depth. Now, what does it mean? It means that fish have a problem because the body grows in depth. So if you make a fish that is long like this, if you make it double as long, it grows 8 times heavier, 2 times 2 times 2, because length cubed. But the surface area grows only squared. So, anyway, so you see the similarity between gills and radiator. And now, before I couldn't explain why gills are limited, and then limiting, and then I stumbled on this calm, and then I had this idea explaining it that way. And another version of this, which is also cute, I got to contact some people wrote me, we are a company that makes a science journal for kids, we extract $500 from you, and we turn your scientific paper into a lesson for kids. So I do that because I want to be rich and known and famous. And we gave them $500 and they turned a paper into what I'm presenting to you into something that kids can use. This is a lesson now that you can download. And they invented the little fish, the little cute fish, cute as hell, very cute, okay. And they are 1 millimeter, very tiny cute fish, and they have 6 sides of 1 square millimeter each. So each of them has a surface area of 6 millimeters squared, and the volume is 1 millimeter cubed. So they have 6 surface unit for 1 weight unit. And let's skip the medium one. It's not Goldilocks here, we do the opposite as Goldilocks. And we go to the big guy, and this is 4 millimeter. The sides are 96. The volume is 64 millimeters cubed. The ratio is 1.5 to 1. So if you are a cell in the middle of this fish, you get the supply of oxygen is much better, is 4 times better here than here. The bigger you get, the more difficult it is. Now, fish don't respire through the skin to the outside, but basically the principle is the same. So that is explained. and we could essentially all go home. But we can expand that. And actually, this happens, this stuff happens in nature all over. Length increase a certain weight, and then weight increase as a volume, as a length squared, and there's some surface area doesn't increase fast enough. For example, elephants have a big problem. Well, they have lots of problems, but they cannot get rid of the heat easily. And how do they get rid of heat? Really, they really get rid of the heat. Now, the volume of an elephant that generates heat is in the third dimension, the surface area of the ear is a square. There is a point at which the thing would look like Jumbo, or it's called Dumbo, and they would drag the ear behind themselves. That wouldn't work. So at some point, getting rid of heat is limiting. And there is also gravity. Your body grows to the third power of weight, of length, and the surface area of your legs with a square. Now, I have made a picture for you because I want, again, to be rich and famous, but I really, this I had to overcome myself to make that picture because, Alan, your children cover their eyes. This is horrible. Now, here, I'm arachnophobe, and I actually hate this. Now, you see this picture, you see daddy long legs, they are very tiny, right? And they have very thin legs. A tarantula has very big legs. This is, you don't scale. As the tarantula grows the body, it becomes heavier faster than the leg can carry. So the legs have to grow strong, more faster than would be expected if you just scaled up a daddy long leg. That's the principle, right? That the surface area of the legs, the cross section of the legs, has to grow faster because the weight grows faster than the cross section of the legs. This is really a challenge for me. Okay. Now, because of this, any fish that grows, as it gets bigger, has less and less surface area. That we know that now from our square fish, or from the gills, from the general patterns. This is what happens. So, a big fish will have less oxygen in its body, never mind the oxygen outside, in its body to do things with. Now, yeah, we can demonstrate that. This is from a Japanese paper. They have at each stage of a carp. I know that carp are not very popular. Think of something else. This is a cold shot. You like cold. This is a cold shot. Okay. So the cold shot that you can see here has gills growing to the power that is very similar to weight, but less actually. It's 0.8 and 0.9794. That means the adults. This one. That means as the carp get bigger, the surface area and hence the oxygen supply declines. Now that means that at some point the growth must stop, because at some point they don't get enough oxygen just to survive. Now we humans and mammals, we maintain a certain temperature. How much is it? 37 approximately, all the time. Whether it's winter, whether it's summer, whether we're in Antarctica or in the tropics. We have clothes, we don't have clothes, or we might put all kinds of things, but we maintain our temperature. Fish don't. You all know that fish adopt the temperature of the environment. What does it mean actually? It means that a fish has to breathe more. It has to breathe more, and I will explain why they actually have to breathe more. So if the temperature is increased, the fish has to breathe more. Now, at some point, I mentioned the oxygen that you get is just enough to keep you going. If you have to breathe more because it's warmer, then you will have to remain smaller. See, if at this size you have to stop growing because you get less and less oxygen per unit weight, then this is the maximum weight you can reach. Then if you increase that, if that increased because of temperature, then you have to remain smaller. And so you can explain why fish now, because of global warming, will tend to be smaller. And we can also explain why, for example here, the squids are bigger in colder water or at lower latitudes. That's just a bunch of squids. Who cares about squids? Calamari. Or you can explain why ichthyologists, people who study fish and make beautiful book about them, why they note that a fish that has a wide geographical range will tend to be bigger, at the cold end of the range. So on the coast here, a fish from the south of Western Australia will be bigger than a fish in the north, and vice versa in the northern hemisphere, in the same species. This is something that is, everybody knows that, but they don't explain it the way I just did. And we generalized this in a paper that attracted all kinds of people. You see, they have a little demo, they make a little demo, and it was a paper that we did. And indeed, you can predict that global warming will make the fish smaller. Now, this is free lecture, so you have to do something. If it were not free, I would have to explain things that are nice and interesting. This is free lecture, so you have to work. And you have to work, understand this model. And if I could make it up when I was in my 30s, you can follow now. This little thing, DWDT, is an expression that says growth rate. How much you grow. Okay, that's growth rate. And the growth rate is really the difference between two things. One thing makes the body bigger. It's called synthesis of body substance. And another thing makes the body smaller. It's called catabolism. It's a bad thing that happened to your body. Now, we just go into the detail. This synthesis is making protein. The animal body makes protein out of amino acids that are synthesized. And for this, it needs oxygen. And it needs ATP, adenosine triphosphate. And this requires oxygen. So this process of protein synthesis requires oxygen, but the growth of the gills is less than the growth of the weight. So this value D, which is easy to remember, it's D for Daniel. this value D is less than 1, and it is less than 1. I have shown you because the gill don't keep up with the weight, and we can see this value of D. You remember the carp with 0.8? Well, there you are. This is the tuna with 0.9, the most fish with 0.8, 0.7, This is guppies with about 0.7 or 0.5. So basically, fish have this power of weight that is less than one, and that causes the gill to grow more slowly than weight itself. And I'll skip that. So, what is the negative term? You might know that protein, enzymes that we have in our bodies and fish have, they consist of chain of amino acids that are folded, and they are folded at four levels. And when the folding is finished, they have a certain shape, and this shape enables a protein to react with another one. It's like a lock and a key. This shape is called quaternary structure. Now, this shape is easily destroyed by shocks. The molecule hit against each other. And shocks is another word for temperature, because temperature is nothing but molecules hitting each other. So the molecule is hitting each other. And so if you increase the temperature, you increase the shocks, and more molecules fall apart. And as soon as a molecule has fallen apart, has lost its shape, even if it has the element that it had before, but if it has lost its shape, it needs to be resynthesized. Because it doesn't work anymore. It's like a key that you put in a lock. If you bend that key, it has lost its shape. It doesn't work, even if it has the same weight as before, the same metal and everything. It doesn't work because the shape is different. So that is called denaturation. Our body consists of molecules that denature really fast. Some of them last a few days. For example, I think that hemoglobin, the thing that transports oxygen in our body, lasts a few days. They are other molecules that last a few weeks, but they all turn over. Our bodies is constantly resynthesized, and falling apart and resynthesized. That's life. So this protein degradation needs no oxygen. So you have something that is proportional to body, and something that is not proportional to body. So you have exactly the two things that I was showing you, something increasing very fast that is connected with the weight, and something that is increasing a little bit slower connected with the surface. At some point, they meet and it's over. Now, this amino acid pool that you have is actually fed mostly by the food that you eat as a fish. And it comes from protein degradation, but also from the food. And it's used in the energy metabolism, it's used to resynthesize. But actually, the energy metabolism also enables us, or the fish, sorry, to breathe, to swim, to forage, to digest, to do things. And so everything that causes these activities to be increased, decrease that activity, because the oxygen is limited. So they do one or the other. They are active or they grow. Now, farmed fish, for example, are very quiet. Why? Because you don't want fish that are hyperactive eating your food. You want very quiet. In fact, farm animals are also very quiet compared with the wild form, for the same reason. So all of this, at the end of the day, ends up with gill area. Now, the amount of oxygen that goes through the gill is not only a question of surface, it's a question of how thick the gill themselves are. It's also a question of the difference in oxygen level between the body and the outside, but actually it is all proportional to surface area, and the surface area doesn't increase as fast. We are thrown in the model, we can relax. So we can make some observation. For example, that fish have a tendency to grow like rapidly and then slowly, and then at some point they stop growing. And then you have the observation, and then you have the explanation. And one explanation that many people give in literature about why fish stop growing, and can I ask the woman to listen now? There's an interesting little thing. So why fish stop growing? Because they spawn. So the fish reproduce, therefore they don't grow anymore. That makes a lot of sense, right? You cannot do lots of things at the same time. But in fish, actually, first of all, let's define, what is a female? A zoologist actually have a definition. It is the gender that puts most effort in reproduction. So that you define if you were going to outer space or to Mars, and there would be some being hopping around, you would, and they would have two gender, you would define the female as the one that makes the heaviest reproductive investment. That is the definition. So if reproductive investment was the reason why you stop growing, the female would have to be smaller. And they are, in humans, as a rule, a little bit smaller, but not in fish. In fish, 70% of the fish species, that's a female that's bigger. Therefore, it cannot be that it is the reproductive investment that caused fish to stop growing. It cannot be. And yet, you find that again and again and again. I wonder if it has to do with the fact that most fishery scientists are male. Anyway, just an aside. So I use Gothic character, Gothic letters always for important pronouncements, like the Bible, you know. And it's written, it is because why the female get bigger, it is because they are generally calmer and thus can devote more oxygen to growth. That's the reason. Essentially, if they are a bit calmer, 95% approximately of the oxygen and energy spent by a fish is actually in activities. It's not growing, it's being active. So you just be a bit calmer, you grow better, everything is fine. Now, next, that is complicated. Basically, if you feed a fish, it turns the food into growth. But as the fish get bigger, it turns less and less of this food into growth. And at some point, none of the food is turned into growth, and they don't grow. They eat, but they don't grow. I would like to see that. I would like to have that. But anyway, so there is no good explanation for it. Why should a fish eat and not grow? While when it was a bit smaller, it grew. The fact is that in order to grow, you have to be able to associate to the food a certain quantity of oxygen, because food is not energy. Contrary to what we always say, food is not energy. Food has to be matched with a certain quantity of oxygen in order to burn, because that's what metabolism is burning of food. And so a fish can eat, but if it doesn't have enough oxygen, it cannot grow. Now, here comes the tricky part. So this fish here lives in cold water, gets big, and spawns at a smaller size, right? At a smaller size, and therefore the oxygen consumption is a bit higher than it will be when it stops growing. The, let's call it Q, the oxygen consumption. There it is a bit higher than it will be when it stops growing. So let's find a fish that is 60 centimeters would spawn at 40 centimeters. A fish that is, I don't know, 1 meter, it will spawn at 60 centimeters. Okay, fine. Now you increase temperature on the fish. They cannot spawn at the same temperature, at the same size as before, because they're not going to reach that size. So they have to spawn earlier at a smaller size. So if you increase the metabolic rate, the size at which you spawn also has to increase. And the metabolic rate at which spawning is initiated also has to increase. And so you can compute the ratio of this, and actually you expect it to be the same as that ratio. And lo and behold, it is the same ratio. It is the same ratio in tuna, in perches, in all kind of fish, and in guppy. The same ratio, but 1.2 to 1.4. In all fish, it's the same ratio. That is, when I discovered that, I sent it to a journal, and the editor said, it's a nice idea. I'm going to send it for review. I had six reviews saying crazy. This is crazy. But they were so negative, so virulently nasty, that the man said, there must be something to it. And he sent it to some old guy called David Cushing, and he says, oh, it's good stuff. We publish it. And so a paper was published that had six negative reviews and one positive review. Yeah, that's rare. The editor, by the way, lived in a windmill. And it was a pommy who later emigrated to Australia. So you have all the, actually, what am I saying? So another observation is that fish, when they are big, they are in deeper water. It seems that's trivial, but that is also explained. Because when you are in deeper water, the water is usually cooler. And if you can reduce your metabolic rate, you can grow some more. So if you want to grow as a fish, you go into deeper water. Now, this is, I found it in an FAO manual. A manual that explains how aquaculturists, people who farm fish, can aerate the pond. People who farm fish can aerate the pond, like we do in aquaria. We pump air in an aquarium. You can also in a pond aerate it. But why should you aerate it? Because the fish need oxygen, and if they get oxygen, they grow better in the pond, given the food that you give. For the same food, they grow better if you are awake than if you don't. And unfortunately, these are different months of the year. The letter is too small. And this is West Africa. He is Morocco, the kingdom of Morocco. He is Senegal, in West Africa. And the fish do this migration, long migration, that's bizarre. And how do they know where they have to be, and why do they do this migration? If you re-express the same coast in terms of temperature, you can see that the temperature changes in the course of a year here. And the fish migrate only to be in the same temperature, because they cannot afford to be in variable temperature. Especially if they are big, because as you now know, being big fish expose yourself to danger, but you can easily choke to death. But being a big fish, you can swim well because the physics, the hydro, whatever, the physics of swimming is actually in favor of big fish. So, now something that is quite terrifying, we have also worked on the poleward migration that come with global warming. You all know, I hope you do, that your fish are kind of moving away. The rock lobster, that is an important fishery here, it is moving south and turning the corner to South Australia. The more northern part of the stock is not doing well at all. Now, that is not an isolated event. This is on the east side of Australia. They have in Sydney fish that were before in Brisbane, and in Brisbane they have fish that were before in Darwin. And they're getting now fish in Tasmania that were in New South Wales. And the same thing happens in the Northern Hemisphere. In New York, they have fish from Florida and so on. The fish are all moving, and outside of the tropics, you have that situation there. You have fish with a affinity to cold water, and from the 70s on, these fish have migrated out of wherever they were and gone toward the poles. And they have been replaced by fish that are more, that are from warmer affinities. And this process will continue, and we have done lots of simulation also in Australia, also with Australian colleagues, that show this process will continue. Now, in the tropics, that means in Darwin, for example, they start with tropical fish and a few subtropical species. They go, the subtropical fish will be the first to go, and then the tropical fish will go. But there will be no fish from the hypertropics replacing them, because the hypertropics don't exist. So there will be no replacement. So in Darwin, they will see the fish gradually disappear. And you can make this worse when you imagine you go a bit north and you have Indonesia with lots of people depending on fish, lots of fishes, and they will disappear, their fish, and they will not know why. Why? Because they don't have researchers that can differentiate the effect of fishing, the effect of dynamic in the reef, of poisoning the reef, cutting the mangrove, and global warming. They will not be able to tell which of these things happen, because it will all happen at the same time. We are almost ready. Now, I don't want to make a statement about fishing, angling, but actually when you angle the fish out of the water, it cannot breathe, right? So the oxygen level in its body goes down, and the pH goes down, and the fish dissolve itself. It actually goes into autolysis. And this can be very strong. And commercial fishers in Hawaii have commissioned a study that demonstrate that so-called burnt tuna is what happens. Burnt tuna is mottled flesh that is kind of fairly disgusting. You cannot use it for sushi. It's a result of a fish biting on the line, and the oxygen disappears, the pH goes down, the acid, the lactic acid, breaks down the vacuole of the cells, the enzymes are free, and they start dissolving themselves. So, this is not nice at all. And that's the last thing that is difficult. Then the rest of the presentation is only two slides. Will be very easy. Now, fish and squids and corals and lots of animals have little rings in their bone, in their ear bone, when they have ears, which in squids are difficult to find. But they still have so-called staccolids. Anyway, so in this ear bones, you can see annual rings, like when you take a fish that lives in Tasmania, you will have annual rings, like in trees. I'm not talking about those. I'm talking about rings that are laid out every day. You can see it with electron microscope. They were discovered in the 70s, 1970s, I think. And the question is, what forms them? Why do the fish have daily rings, especially the larvae and the young fish? And basically, it is because, you remember this graph, the metabolic rate, it actually goes up when you're active and goes down when you're inactive. Every time you are active, you get into an oxygen deficit. And some of you will know from running that you get lactic acid in your legs and it hurts, right? That is the result of activity and not having enough oxygen. And fish do that, and you have then active, inactive, active, inactive. This corresponds to lactic acid, no lactic acid, lactic acid, no lactic. And the lactic acid means pH goes down. And the pH going down is like, well, you're in an acidic environment. And you get etching on the otolith. The otolith is etched like you can etch something, put it in acid, and then half a day later, it's not etched. Then etched, not etched. That's the reason why they have rings. Yeah. And there's no other explanation for them. And we're almost ready. We are ready. So, this theory, it explains lots of things, and I have spared you lots of them. For example, I have spared you the fact that that I have discovered only a few months ago that if you grind up a fish and you put it in a blender and you look at enzymes, they have oxidative enzymes, the young ones, the small ones, and if you look at the big ones, they have glycolytic enzyme, fermentative enzyme, the enzyme that you need when you have no oxygen. I didn't know that to be the case, but it is the rule. It is always the case. So we have a mountain of fact that explains this. But it is not, this gold is not widely accepted. And the strange thing is, I experienced the fact that most people cannot, most physiologists or most specialists cannot wrap their mind around the dimension issue, the fact that a surface cannot grow as fast as a volume. Because you don't see it. If you look at a little bit of tissue, you put this in a jar, and then you measure the oxygen respiration. But they will come around, and then they will understand a bit better what breathing is and what it implies for fish. And we are all happy that we don't have gills, because you couldn't breathe through that. That's what it means to have gills. Thank you very much.
Give him a hard time. Go ask.
Evolution is something you didn't mention. I'm just wondering.
I did. Okay. I showed you it.
I'm just wondering about the capacity to deal for variation, to deal with some of these limitations. Clearly, there's been a lot of attempts for fishing world have had to deal with this problem, so there's been a lot of effort, evolutionary speaking, to deal with this problem. Can we expect evolution to sustain fishing in hotter water?
No, because so first of all, evolution has dealt with this problem by growing big gills, right? It cannot get around the fact that the surface and the volume are different, but it can grow big gills in fish that can deal with big gills. For example, if you have monster gills like tuna, you cannot live in estuaries because they get clogged up and stuff. So evolution has dealt with this. Now, evolution cannot deal with global warming because it happens much too fast. Evolution can be very fast when it comes to external attributes. For example, I understand that the cane toad in 30, 40 years, that means more or less in 30, 40 generation, has got longer legs. Well, cane toad have longer legs now because they can hop faster. They have short legs in where they started in Queensland, and they have longer legs now in Darwin and stuff. That is an external attribute, the coloration or the proportion of the limbs. But temperature is a different thing because each enzyme in the body is geared toward has a shape that is optimal for a certain temperature, and that enzyme links with that enzyme, and that enzyme links with that enzyme, you know, Krebs cycle. And so, to change one thing, you have to change all of them. Now, evolution can do that, but it needs millions of years. You can take a tropical fish, turn it into a polar fish, if you give me 3 million years. But global warming is much too fast. So, the fish do not adapt. And you can see, in the migration that I presented for West Africa, it's cheaper for the fish to move than to adapt. Yeah. Yeah, please.
So it's kind of like a two-part question. These are the words. With the tuna example, you said that kind of the burnout with the acid. Is there another fish species or type that has a similar size to gill ratio that burns out in the same way as the tuna does?
I would expect this also to be the case, with the swordfish, and they have similar if they are played a long time, and in fact some fish do not recover from being played because their body are paralyzed. I don't do angling, but the fish fight for a certain time, and then after a while they stop. That at that point they are paralyzed in pain and the tissue are compromised. And if a fish, I remember fishing in the Java Sea commercially or research, and we threw lots of fish, and some of them they would not recover. They were not dead, but they did not recover, and some of them recover right away. So if you get, a deck full of fish, the groupers would recover if we threw them back, but the mackerels would not. The fastest swimming fish that need lots of oxygen.
Yeah, because then it's clearly like a physical constraint that this ratio.
Yeah.
The other part of the question would be if you notice the difference between the saltwater and freshwater species, and how much does the osmo regulation have a part in it? Because you have to do that to rebuild the problem.
So I just wanted to add one thing. The reason why we know that for tuna is because the flesh is affected. You cannot sell it. Whereas the recreational fisher don't do investigation of the flesh of the fish that they release. The difference between freshwater and marine fish, it actually makes no difference, this story. the story is exactly the same in freshwater and in marine water. The only difference is that there is an added cost of osmo regulation when they go from one milieu to the other. And the strange thing is that the cost of adapting to different salinities is doesn't seem to change with temperature. So it is high in cold water, and there are very few fish that can move from one to the other in cold water. But in the tropics, the metabolic rate goes up, and the cost of osmoregulation doesn't. So it seems that the benefit of, for example, for marine fish to go into freshwater for getting food, there is no major cost for them for osmoregulation. So you have lots of marine fish in freshwater, in the tropics, but not in cold water.
Is it possible that the fish, instead of migrating to cooler water, just stop growing as
yeah.
much?
So they do not, first of all, they do not migrate to cooler water. It's the water that migrate, right? And they try to stay in the same water. And it's true that they do not migrate totally. They go into deeper water to a certain extent, that we can demonstrate very easily, and some of them do not migrate and they suffer short, they become shorter. But basically they will do a compromise between these three solutions. There is the one that migrate, the one that go into deeper water, and the one that get shorter. And at some point, the one that gets smaller are not competitive anymore, and the population grows that has migrated. But really, they don't go into cooler water, right? It's a cooler water at most.
The species like tunas that are...
Pardon?
I said, for species like tunas that are kind of on the edge of the design envelope, do you think their diets will change in response to changing oxygen availability? They'll be forced to forage on things that are less energy
yeah.
to chase down.
This is a good point, and I don't know it for tuna, but there are lots of changes in the sea that certain forage fish species appear. For example, the birds in California, the seabirds in California, eat now aphosid, zooplankton, well, before they were eating small fatty fish that were very good. And so they clutch success, or the egg laying, whatever, they are falling apart and the population is declining. So there will be always life in the ocean. Viruses, bacteria, or whatever. The point is that the big things that we like big animals, right? They are compromised because they are the first, they are more at the edge. So they are the one that are compromised, the one that will disappear.
Other questions?
The otolith etching.
The what?
The etching on the
yeah.
otoliths, the day rings. How are you certain it's not due to deposition and metabolistic effects on deposition?
Well, that's what it is. During the time where oxygen is plenty, during the period of calm, there is a certain type of deposition,
yeah.
And during the time when they are very active, there is another kind of deposition,
okay.
Including deposition that is affected by low pH.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
With the big fish, you know, particularly suffering. Do you see a species turnover happening there, you know, like the favourite fish and those more little species, you know, coming to dominate the community?
Well, yeah.
First.
A few years ago, I kind of postulated that there is a fishing down effect,
yeah.
And basically the fauna becomes smaller, and you can document that everywhere. And the funny thing is that the fisheries induce that also, and so they are difficult to separate out, the two effects. But global warming by itself can induce a reduction of the size of all organisms. That is happening, and even in the plankton it happens, because datum cells are very big, flagellates are very small, and you can see with the decreased temperature that you go from diatoms to flagellate. That is, it happens at all scales. Yeah. Yeah, Jessica?
So, first of all, thank you for a very interesting presentation, Daniel, and for us biologists who've been focused on food webs for years, to be told, no, it's not about food, it's about oxygen, is challenging, but enlightening. Given that you've just reminded us that we already know that the biggest fish in a population within the species are the most important ones, are the big breeders, big old fat females. We all want to be valued for being old and fat. And so you've just now told us that those are also the fish at biggest risk because they're already basically suffocating and they're at their limit. So what are the implications for conservation strategies and marine protected areas?
Well,
Dorothy Dixer, sorry.
There is all kind of responses at a different scale. The big scale is that we ought to stop the engine of global warming, and that's emission, carbon dioxide emission. That is really we should vote according to that, because that's the end of the world, if this can continue. At a more local scale, we have to create spaces where animals can be, big animals can be, without being harmed, because they're already living at the edge. And if we fish them, if we boil them in the water, if they cannot be. And so we have to have parks where we don't, or nature reserve, where we don't go after them. Because if they don't have any place where they can do their thing, they won't do their thing. It is kind of, yeah. We need marine parks and reserves, and we shouldn't angle, we shouldn't fish in them. We should let the fish alone. This big old female that contributes so much to the larvae and to the eggs that are necessary to maintain the pollution, the population, a little bit of fishing will threaten them. And actually the anglers go after those, because this will give you kudos to get a big fish. You don't get kudos for small fish. So it's like the hunters who go after animals that have, oh, you don't have those here. But anyway, they kill the best animals that have these horns and these antlers, and what is left is runts, and that is not that is the opposite of what happens in nature that has brought about these beautiful animals. Yeah.
I had a question related to the food part, because you described I think it was the daily autolytes growth deposition. With oxygen, and I know they have been independently explained the yearly autolyte growth with just the food and temperature. Where does the food fit with oxygen? Does it go in the same direction?
The thing is, this theory I've developed on the basis of food is there, and I would see how far I go assuming that food is there. And I've done this explicitly. Now, most colleagues implicitly do the opposite. They do, oxygen is there, let's look our food there, how far you go. But the point is that food can be stored. For example, shark can have another fish in its stomach for days and months, actually. And and can go on, but it cannot live 2 minutes without oxygen. We cannot live 2 minutes without oxygen. So oxygen is regulating our life far more than we think, and fish even more. I don't think that it's correct to assume that the oxygen is always there. And this assumption is made when you say the food isn't there, there's not enough food, and they don't grow like this or that because of food. There's always the assumption that there's enough oxygen, as if oxygen was not needed to grow. It's almost like if you wanted a car, well, when I was young, you could soup up a car to go faster, right? And what would you do first? Would you make a bigger tube for the fuel line, or you would be a bigger carburetor with bigger air intake?
Can you plug in the food though?
Pardon?
Can you say, well, you start with assuming that food is there, but then kind of modify
what is
not?
This theory, the gold needs, will have to be modified, will have to be adjusted. And I do hope the food has to be brought in. And I kind of put it aside, the same way that people put aside the oxygen when they do this. And I try to go as far as possible without bringing the food in. Yeah.
Thank you.
All right.
Can in some way, like the animal, the individual, in a short period of time, so even within one generation, cope in some way with the use of the oxygen that is available?
No.
By altering
no.
the behavior?
No, they cannot. Because the biochemical system that animals use have evolved 4 billion years. They have been honed 4 billion years with evolution. They have been optimized for billion years, and to change them in a few generations is not possible. That's my point about, you can change the color of an animal. You can breed horses that have different shape, or dogs or something. But the biochemical mechanism, that you cannot change very rapidly.
Need the biggest radiator, right? So because like you don't warm up as much. So if you're a fish and the availability of oxygen is fixed, but you just alter the behavior, you cope with the behavior, you buffer with it.
Well, there's a price to pay though. If you increase the temperature and there is less free oxygen to grow, because it goes into resynthesizing body molecules that have fallen apart, there is a price to pay. They will not grow that fast. There is more the food would be diverted, of the food also, toward resynthesis. Life can cope, but there is always a price to pay. Because the system are optimized for a certain temperature. So if you work at another temperature, there is a price to pay. There is no free lunch, in other words. I think...
On that note, if there's no further questions, I want to thank Daniel, and I hope you all come back next year for some